Hey, good morning. In the last class, we discussed about coordinate systems. So we learned how to define a coordinate system using three perpendicular surfaces. So we choose three surfaces. If you remember anyway in the last class, for a coordinate system, you require three surfaces. U1 equals to constant. U2 equals to constant and U3 equals to constant. So these are three surfaces. Now in case of Cartesian system, these three surfaces are planes. YZ plane, XZ plane and XY plane. In case of electrical system, these three surfaces are what? The first one is a cylinder of radius rho. The second one is a half plane which is passing through the z axis and making an angle phi with the x axis. And the third surface was xy plane. Now we are coming to the spherical coordinate system. Now in case of this spherical coordinate system, u1 is r, u2 is theta and u3 is phi, and three surfaces which we say r equals to constant, theta equals to constant and phi equals to constant. Now this is basically representing a sphere of radius r. This is representing cone making an angle theta with z axis and vertex at 0, 0, 0 and axis as z axis. And the third one is half plane. It is similar to the cylindrical coordinate system. This is half plane making an angle phi with axis. So these are the three surfaces we use to define the spherical coordinate system. Now if I just try to draw a diagram superimposing with the xyz system. So this is my x, this is y and this is z, which is the Cartesian coordinate system. And suppose if I represent a point P, this is xyz and this is r, theta and phi. So this point is basically lying on the surface of the sphere first. So what you need to imagine, this is a sphere of a radius r and center at 0, 0, 0. So you need to consider a sphere of radius r here having center at 0, 0, 0. Okay. So you have, and this point is lying on the surface of that sphere. The second surface we are talking about is theta equals to constant. So this is a theta making an angle, this is basically a cone which is around the z axis. So you have a situation something like this. So it's something like this, and you have, if you just consider it, it is something. So this is a part of your sphere, this is part of your cone. So three dimensional picture is not possible to draw here. So I'm not drawing the three dimensional version here. But the intersection of this cone, now if you look at the sphere, it's just you can think of a ball anyway, a hollow ball. So a sphere of radius r, and then you insert a cone, coinciding its vertex with the center of the sphere anyway. So you have something like this. Just imagine the ice cream cone anyway, whose tip is at the center 0, 0, 0, and it is intersecting the sphere. So the intersection of the sphere and cone is a circle. Okay, and the circle has a center on the z axis. Right? Now think of the glass surface. Phi equals to constant. Now this is very same as we discussed in case of cylindrical coordinate system. So this phi is representing a plane, a half plane which is passing through the z axis. and making an angle phi. So what do I do here? I just make a projection as I did in case of this is considered as a projection P prime, and then this is my y prime, this is my x prime, and if you remember, this value is our x value, this value is our y value, and if I connect this center, this angle is my phi angle, okay? And then what is theta here? Theta is basically representing this angle, and this is the point of our consideration. And if you look at the z value, better that you write it like this, and this is your. So x, y, z are clear, and what is r here? This value is r anyway, because this is the radius of the sphere. So from diagram, all the variables are clear anyway. What is theta here? Theta is the angle which is the line joining the point P to the origin is making an angle theta. Phi is an angle with the x-axis, and r is the radius of the sphere which you are imagining. So by considering these three surfaces, when you design these three surfaces, these three surfaces will interact at a unique point, and that unique point would be your design coordinate. So either you use x, y, z to specify this coordinate, this point, or you use large theta phi to specify this point. Now we have an interrelationship between these coordinates anyway, or we can develop a relationship between x, y, z and r theta phi. Now to develop the relationship between x, y, z and r theta phi, what you need to do, this is r anyway, so this angle is you can simply calculate the value of z from this triangle. This is the triangle we are considering. So what will be the value of z? Z is basically the projection of r on the horizontal side. So z is simply r cos theta, fine. Now from this triangle, as we did earlier, this, what is this value? This value is, if I write O P prime, is what? This is the projection on the horizontal side, projection of r on the vertical side anyway. So this becomes r sin theta. Now what is the value of x? OP prime cos phi, and what is the value? OP prime sin phi. So when I substitute the value of OP prime here, this becomes x equals to r sin theta cos phi, y equals to r sin theta sin phi, and z equals to r cos theta. So these are the three relations. So if you know the values of r, theta and phi, you can calculate the values of x, y and z from these relations. Okay. Now you can also develop the inverse relations. Now inverse relation means, now if I square and add these two, so if I calculate the value of x square plus y square plus z square, then you will get r square sin square theta cos square phi plus r square sin square theta sin square phi plus r square cos square theta. Now we club these two together, this is r square sin square theta cos square phi plus sin square phi plus r square cos square theta. Okay, now this becomes 1, and this r square, r square, so this is finally r square. So this is one relation, x square plus y square plus z square equals to r square. Fine? Then so you have one relation, r equals to x square plus y square plus z square square. Okay, this is first. Now second, what you do, you just calculate y by x, which is r sin theta sin phi r sin theta cos phi. So this is tan phi, this and this goes off. So it means phi equals to tan inverse y by x. So this is your second relation. And then you calculate the value of x square plus y square, which is r square sin square theta cos square phi plus r square sin square theta sin square phi. So this gives you r square sin square theta cos square theta plus cos square phi plus sin square phi is 1. So this becomes 1. So you get from here r equals to r sin theta equals to x square plus y square. Then we have a relation r cos theta equals to z. So divide this two, you will get tan theta equals to x square plus y square over z. So theta equals to tan inverse x square plus y square divided by z. So this is your third relation. So finally we have theta equals to tan inverse x square plus y square divided by z, and phi equals to tan inverse y by x. So these are the three relations, and earlier we have the forward relations given by this. Okay, so these two set of transformation equations can be used to convert r theta phi convert r theta phi to xyz and vice versa. So if you know one of the set of the coordinates, you can convert it to the spherical system, or you can convert it to the Cartesian system using this relation. So this is about interconversion. Now next to that, now unit vectors in this system, so we represent unit vector by AR, A theta and A phi, and because these three surfaces are perpendicular to each other, you have a rule AR dot AR would be A theta dot A theta and A phi dot A phi would be 1. Okay, then you have AR dot A theta equals to A theta dot A phi equals to A phi dot AR, all be 0 and their reverse orders. Okay, because dot products can be dot product is commutative, so this will be equals to A theta AR and so on. Okay, then you have AR cross AR would be equals to 0 equals to A theta cross A theta equals to A phi cross A phi. All these would be equals to 0, and then AR cross A theta would be A phi. A theta cross A phi be AR, and A phi cross AR would be A theta. And if you change the order anyway, a minus sign will be introduced in front of this. Okay, so if you change the order of A theta and AR, then this will be minus A phi. A phi A theta will be minus AR and AR. So there will be three more relations. So these are the properties of the unit vectors anyway, because the system is orthogonal anyway. So in every coordinate system which we define, if it is orthogonal, this kind of relationship would be there. Now, if we try to calculate the values of h1, h2, h3 anyway, using that relation del L over del U1, this is how we can calculate the value of h1, h2 and h3. So this is del L over del U2, and this is del L over del U3. Now if I calculate these values here, then if you remember, h1 is del of L is basically x a x plus y a y plus z a z divided by del of u1. U1 is r here. Okay. Now you need to substitute the values of these x, y, and z in z in terms of r theta phi. So you remember the values anyway. Del over del r of x is what? If you remember the relations which I have written earlier, it is r sin theta cos phi a x plus r sin theta sin phi a y plus r cos theta a z. Now you can find out the differentiation and then get the value here. So this is going to be sin theta cos phi a x plus sin theta sin phi a y plus cos of theta a z. Now if I take the magnitude of this vector, this will be square. So this is sin square theta cos square phi plus sin square theta sin square phi plus cos square theta. So this becomes anyway, this sin square theta and cos will become 1, and this is finally going to be 1. So h1 is equals to 1. Then we calculate the value of h2. So for calculating the value of h2, what do you need to do? You have to just simply substitute it here, and this will be del by del of u2. So u2 is what? Theta here, and then the results will follow from here. Yes. So this becomes del of del theta of r is r sin theta cos phi a x plus r sin theta sin phi a y plus r cos theta a z. We need to find the magnitude of this differentiation. Now, just do the differentiation. This becomes r will be treated as a constant in cos phi. So r cos phi, this will be r cos phi, and this sin theta will be cosine of theta ax. Okay, if you differentiate it, plus r sin phi, and this sin theta will become cos theta here. Plus, sorry, this is ay here, and minus r sin theta is it. Now if I calculate the magnitude of this, this becomes r square cos square phi cos square theta plus r square sin square phi cos square theta plus r square sin square theta. Now here r square cos square theta is common, so this becomes r square cos square theta cos square phi plus sin square phi plus r square sin square theta. So this becomes finally, and of course there is a square root sign, so in the earlier case also I missed there, so this becomes finally r. Okay, so this r square cos square theta and r square sin square theta will be clubbed together and will give you r square, and square root of r will be r simply here. So second value is r. Now in the third case, if I calculate the value of h3, this h3 is del phi, and this is del by del phi. The only change will appear here you have to differentiate now with respect to y. So this would be r sin theta sin phi with a minus sin ax plus r sin theta cos phi ay plus z. Okay, because this is r and theta dependent term, so this the differentiation of this with respect to phi would become zero. So now magnitude of this would be r square sin square theta sin square phi plus r square sin square theta cos square phi square. Now if you look at this, this is going to be r sin theta. So the value here is r sin theta. So these are the three scale factors. These h values are basically known as scale factors for the spherical coordinate system. You remember anyway, these h values are basically defined to convert u1, u2, u3 into the dimensions of the length, because u1, u2, u3 are not necessarily length. And in this case, if you look at the u1, u2, u3 of a spherical coordinate system, u1 is r, which is the radius. So you don't require any conversion factor. So one is there. U2 is your theta, which is an angle and which is dimensionless. So you multiply it by r, and it becomes the length. And u3 is your phi. Phi is an angle again. So it is dimensionless. So you need to multiply it by r sin theta wherever it is, and it gives you the value of dimension of length. So this is about h1, h2, h3. So now you have knowledge of u1, u2, u3, and h1, h2, h3 for the spherical coordinate system. Now you can proceed with the writing of length vector. So length element, which is we define as the dl, and if you remember, this is dl1 au1 dl2 au2 plus dl3 au3. Remember, and this dl1 dl is, if you remember, the value is this is h1 du1 a1 plus h2 du2 au2 h3 du3 au3. And now you have the values h1 is 1 and du1 will become dr, this is ar, h2 is r, this is d theta a theta, and this is r sin theta d phi k phi. So this is the value of your length vector in a spherical coordinate system. Similarly, we have a surface. Now surface is defined as dl2 dl3 au1 plus dl1 dl3 au2 and dl1 dl2 au3. So this is the value of the surface vector, or small surface vector in general coordinate system. And if I convert it in terms of h1, h2, h3, this becomes h2, h3, du2, du3, au1, h1, h3, du1, du3, au2, and this is h1, h2, du1, du2, au2. Now if I substitute the values of h1, h2, h3 here from this, and u1, u2, u3, this becomes h2, h3 is r square sin theta, and this is d theta d phi ar, plus h1 is 1, h3 is r sin theta dr d phi a theta, plus h1, h2, and h1, h2 is r dr d theta, sorry, a phi. So this is the value of your surface vector in case of a spherical coordinate system, right? And then you have volume V, which is a scalar quantity, which is dl1, dl2, dl3, and this becomes h1, h2, h3, du1, du2,
du3, and if I substitute the values, it is r square sine theta dr d theta and d phi. So these are the three elements which we frequently use in electromagnetic analysis. Anyway, this is the length vector, this is the surface vector, and this is the volume scalar. So wherever you require these, you can substitute, because if you are working in a Cartesian system, then you have a different definition of length vector, surface vector, and volume. Or if you are working in any other coordinate system, you can accordingly define, because this is a general recipe which we are following. We can define our own coordinate system, and we can define the length, area, and volume in that coordinate system by determining the values of h1, h2, and h3, which are the scale factors required to write the length, area, and volume vectors. Right? This is about the spherical coordinate system. Now we move on to the this is what we have covered so far, all these coordinate systems and their scale factors we have now. Now we move on to the next topic, which is gradient of a scalar. After that, we'll discuss about divergence of a vector field and curl of a vector field. So now I start with what I mean by a scalar field. First of all, a scalar field means you have a function like this. A quantity, a physical quantity, which is defined by a scalar function. Now this quantity, suppose this is a temperature, for example. If it is a temperature, then this describes the value of the temperature in the whole space. So you have to just substitute the values of x, y, and z. As you substitute the values of x, y, and z, you obtain the value of phi for that particular point. So it gives you the information about a scalar quantity in the whole space. Fine? So scalar function means a scalar quantity which is defined for the whole space. Similarly, we can define a vector field also. Vector field will be a vector quantity defined for the whole space. So in general, in the general coordinate systems, this phi would be function of u1, u2, and u3. u1, u2, u3 are any set of coordinates anyway. u1, u2, u3 may be your xyz, which is Cartesian coordinate system. It may be rho, phi, and z in the cylindrical coordinate system, and it may be r, theta, and phi in the spherical coordinate system. So these are this is the scalar field. Now we want to define a particular operation of the scalar field, which is known as a gradient of a scalar field. And for that, I consider a particular example in here, because instead of considering phi, I prefer to consider t here, which is function of x, y, z. Because Cartesian system is simple to understand, so I start with an example from the Cartesian system, then I will make it generalized for the all coordinate systems. Okay, so t is a temperature distribution. Now I use a diagram here, two spherical or two circular surfaces, and this is your center here, now maybe, and this is suppose R, this is O, and this is a vector dr, and this is R plus dr. Okay? Now at this surface the temperature is T, and at this surface temperature is T plus dT. Now we are considering basically these lines, this part of the circle basically, or these curved lines are representing a surface where the temperature is constant. So I have connected all the points on which the temperature is T, and I have connected all the points where the temperature is T plus dT, and dT is very very small. It means the variation in the temperature if you move from this line to this line is very very small. Now as I have explained right now, T is a scalar function. Okay, scalar field. So if I write dt using the knowledge of the calculus anyway, you can differentiate this on this. So this is del t by del x dx, del t by del y dy, and del t by del z dz, because t is function of fine. Very simple. Now what I do is here I just decompose this, divide into a vector product notation. So what I do here, I just write this as a del t by del x ax plus del t by del y ay plus del t by del z az, and the dot product of this with another vector which is familiar to you, dx ax dy ay and dz az. Now you just go back, go in the reverse direction. If you take the dot product of these two, you will certainly achieve the first one. Okay. So I'm just decomposing this expression into a vector notation here, and in the next step, I represent this quantity as a del t. I don't know what is the physical meaning of this quantity right now, but this bracket I'm just representing by a notation delta t, and a dot product with the, this is my dl, you know, this is just a position vector, sorry, it is dl in my notation, so I am using l for the length here. So this is what we have. Now what is this dt anyway? Now using the dot product definition, if I just try to find it out, this is, if I open this, this is dl and this is cosine of theta. Now cosine theta is angle between dl and delta t vector. Okay, I don't know what is this delta t right now. I'm sorry, you have to replace this r by l, because in my notation it is simply, because r you will be confused with your spherical notation. Okay, I'm talking about a general coordinate system, and in general coordinate system we are representing length by l. Okay, so this is that's why I'm replacing this r by l. There should not be any confusion. Now look at this expression. Just you have to go to one more step and now this step. So from this step, I am writing it here: dt by dl equals to magnitude of a particular vector, which is represented by this bracket, and then cosine of theta. Fine. Now look at this. I need the diagram. Stage, so I am not removing it, and this is what I am representing as a delta t, which is a vector. Now look at this expression and conclude about dt by, what is dt by dl? It is space rate of change of t x y z. How t is changing with space coordinates. So if I move a dl distance in a space, then what will be the rate of change of temperature? It is basically changing the temperature when I travel a unit distance. But if you remember, it's a distribution of temperature in the space. And when I say distribution of temperature in the space, if I move from this point to this point, or if I move, so there, if I want to move a dl distance, there are infinite possibilities. I can go in this direction, I can go in that direction, I can go in that direction, I can go upward, I can go downward. So there are many possibilities to move a dl distance. Now my question here is, when this dt by dl will be maximum according to this formula? This dt by dl would be maximum because you have a cosine theta on the right hand side, and cosine theta will have value between plus 1 and minus 1. And what is the maximum possible value of cos theta? Which is plus 1. So when cosine theta is 1, this is maximum. So space rate of change is maximum when theta equals to 0 degree, implies that dt by dl maximum is given by this. In that case, if theta equals to 0, then The express rate of change of temperature is maximum and it is defined by the magnitude of the vector delta T. Now this delta T we call as a gradient basically. Now in the second case, yeah, this is all about that. Now look at this. So this delta T is defined by this vector, and this vector is giving you the magnitude of this vector gives you the information about the maximum space rate of change of temperature. Okay, and it also gives you a direction, because the direction, how it gives you the direction, because when theta equals to 0. Now look at this diagram. Now if this is what we are talking about. So if this theta becomes 0, then this dl becomes shortest anyway. You just find it out anyway. You may have dl in various directions. You can have dl from, you can move from this point to this point, this point to this point, because this curve exists everywhere. So if you move from this point to here, in all cases the change in the temperature is dt. Because this is, on this line the temperature is T, on this line the temperature is T plus dT. So when you are moving from this curve, the change in the temperature is always dT. But if you move from this point, the length is larger. If you move from this point, the length is smaller. Okay? So when the theta is 0, the length is the shortest length. And hence the space rate of change of temperature would be maximum. So this is what the physical interpretation of your gradient is now, that you have a vector delta T which we have defined as this. So you have delta T which is defined as and delta T by delta Z is it. So this is a vector which represents, so the direction of this gives the maximum space rate. Okay, remember this is a space rate always, it is not time rate. And then magnitude of delta T, that is delta T gives the value of So we have now a definition, or we have now a new vector which gives you the magnitude and direction of maximum space rate of change of a scalar quantity dxyz. Okay. Now this was specifically anyway we discussed in terms of temperature, but this discussion is valid for all scalar quantities. So if you are having, or if you have a scalar defined in a space, then at every point in the space, you can find out a vector which gives you the information about maximum rate of change of maximum space rate of change of that scalar quantity. So if I have a question anyway, if you have a definition of a scalar quantity given in the space in terms of a mathematical function which is a scalar field, and if you are interested in knowing that in which direction the rate of change of scalar quantity would be maximum, then you have to find out this vector which is known as a gradient of scalar T x y z. So gradient, so this is the physical significance. If somebody asks you what is the physical significance of this gradient vector, then you must say that the gradient gives you the information about magnitude and direction of maximum space rate of change of scalar quantity. So by calculating this at any point you may find that in which direction the rate of change of phi is maximum. Okay? Now I generalize it to the general coordinate system. Now if you remember, the definition of general coordinate system, we use u1, u2, u3 as the coordinates and h1, h2, h3 as the scale factors, which are used basically to convert u1, u2, u3 into the dimension of the length. Now if I represent this in the general means your scalar function is defined as function of u1, u2, u3. In this case, the delta t would be defined as, because what, anyway, if you observe it closely, this is the change in the temperature or change in the scalar quantity with respect to the change in the first length. So I can generalize it like this, del t over del L1 A u1 plus del t over del L2 A U2 plus del T over del L3 A U3. Clear? Now if I substitute the values of L1, L2, L3, then this becomes del T over H1 del U1 A U1 del T over H2 del 2 A U2 plus del T over H3 del U3 L3. So this can be considered as a general definition for the gradient. This can be considered as a definition of gradient of any scalar function T, which is defined in general coordinates u1, u2 and u3. Now if you just want to be specific and you want to write it in various coordinate systems, then what you need to do? You have to just substitute the values of u1, u2, u3, h1, h2, h3 in this expression. So for the Cartesian system, we have already discussed that, but anyway, again to be specific about that, h1, h2, h3 are one anyway, if you remember. U1 is x, u2 is y, and u3 is z, and h1 equals to 1, h2 equals to 1, and h3 equals to 1. So what this becomes? This gradient of scalar function will be del t over del x ax plus del t over del y ay and del t over del z az. Fine? So this is the value of gradient of any scalar function in Cartesian system, because t is defined as x, y, z. Now in cylindrical system, t is rho, y and z. And if you remember in this case, what is u1 is rho, u2 is y and u3 is z, and h1 equals to 1, h2 equals to rho and h3 equals to 1. It was discussed in the last class how to calculate that. Then in this case, delta t would be del t over del r, sorry, this is rho, a rho plus del t over rho del phi a phi plus del t over del z az. So this would be the definition of your gradient of scalar function t in cylindrical coordinate system. And if I just go to the next one, which is spherical coordinate system, where t is defined as r, theta and phi. In that case, if you remember, u1 is your r, u2 is theta and u3 is phi, and h1 is 1, h2 is r and h3 is r sine theta. Then the expression of gradient
del t would be del t over del r ar plus del t over r del theta a theta plus del t over, this is the value of h1, h3, and del r theta phi. So this is del t over, this is going to go away, 1 over r sin theta, del t over del phi a. So this is your expression of gradient of any scalar function in a spherical coordinate system. So this is how you can write gradient of any given function, any given scalar function in various coordinates. So if your definition of scalar is given in xyz, you have to use this formula, and once you calculate these partial derivatives, you will certainly know the magnitude of this vector and direction of this vector. So you can calculate always the direction and magnitude of a vector if these values are known to you. And if you want to be specific, if you want to know the gradient at a particular value of xyz, then you have to substitute the values of xyz in the obtained expression. You will get the values of the value of the magnitude, numerical value of the magnitude, and the direction, a specific direction. Now if your function is given in rho phi z, means in a spherical, in a cylindrical coordinate system, means if you are doing your analysis in cylindrical coordinate system and you happen to find your scalar function as a function of rho phi and z, then you can calculate the value of your gradient of that scalar, which basically gives you the information about maximum space rate of change of that quantity. And then this expression can be used, and if it is given in a spherical coordinate system, you may use this particular expression for finding the gradient of a scalar function. So this is all about your definition of your gradient of a scalar field. What is the physical significance of this vector, gradient of a scalar field, and then how we can find out the gradient of a scalar field if the field is defined in different coordinate system. This is what we discussed. Now next topic is the divergence. Divergence of a vector field. Now suppose if you have a vector quantity which is defined in the space by a vector which is function of space coordinates. So now it is a different situation. You are talking about divergence of a vector field. Now why talk about a vector field first? What do you mean by a vector field first of all? Vector field is very simple. It is simply a vector, but this vector is not a constant vector. It is defined in the whole space. So it is something like this, like the vector is now your function of x, y, z. If I represent it in the Cartesian system, and if I write it in a general system, then A is basically a function of your u1, u2, and u3. So if it is a spherical coordinate system, then u1, u2, u3 are r, theta, and phi. If it is a cylindrical coordinate system, then these u1, u2, and u3 are rho, phi, and z, or x, y, and z in Cartesian system. So this is a vector which is defined as a function of. So in general, I can write like this: a u1, a u1, a u2, a u2, plus a u3, a u3. Remember? Now this is a general vector, and here a u1, a u2, and a u3 are functions of u1, u2, and u3. So that makes a definition of a vector in terms of u1, u2, and u3. Okay, in Cartesian system specifically they are x, y, z, but in general they are u1, u2, u3. So a1, a u1, a u2, and a u3 are known as components of this vector along the three axes which we are using in our coordinate system, and those three axes are u1, u2, and u3. So a u1, a u2, and a u3 are three components along the directions of u1, u2, and u3, and they are functions of u1, u2. Now we define a particular quantity which is denoted by a dot product of a del vector with this vector A, and which has a definition, a mathematical definition I am writing here. Now if you look at this mathematical definition, there are just forget about that, this is just a notation we are talking about. Now look at the numerator first. What is this quantity A dot ds? A dot ds is, if you remember, this represents the flux of a vector field. This is around a closed curve S. So it is basically the outgoing flux. Outward flux of vector field A across the surface S. Fine? So what you are talking about, suppose your vector is defined in the whole space, and if you choose a small surface, so you choose a point basically, and you choose a very small surface which is enclosing that point. So you have a point of consideration, you are imagining or you assume a small surface which is enclosing that point, and this surface is closed. Remember, this is not an open surface because you want to enclose that point. The point should be bounded by a surface. So you are choosing a very small surface area which is enclosing that point of consideration, and you are finding that what is the total outward flux coming out from that particular surface. So this is your numerator, and you are dividing it by the volume. Volume of that enclosure which you have assumed basically. So when you are considering a closed surface, just like the surfaces of this room, there is a volume enclosed by the closed surface. So always the closed surface has a volume inside it. So you are dividing it by the volume. So what this expression, this numerator and denominator is representing, it is basically the net outward flux per unit volume for a given closed surface which is enclosing the point. And then you are putting a limit delta V tending to 0. The meaning hereby is that you reduce or you consider that surface to be very very small, as if the total volume tends to 0. It means you are coming back to the point again. So you have a point, you are starting with a point, you are assuming a very small surface, because for calculating the flux you need to have a surface. You cannot calculate the flux for a point. So you have a point at the start, you are considering a surface around that which is very very small in size. You calculate the net outward flux coming out from that surface per unit volume, so you divide it by the volume, and then finally you put your limit tends to, volume tends to 0. As I say volume tends to 0, you are going back to the point. So this is, in a nutshell, this expression is known as divergence of vector field A, and it represents basically, it is net outward flux per unit volume under the condition that volume tends to 0. So basically you define this particular quantity for a point. So if you are given a vector field, you can always find out, because this is and you remember we have already defined this area vector in various notations, various coordinate systems. So if your vector is defined in Cartesian system, you have to use the definition of ds in Cartesian system, or if it is defined in another coordinate system, then the corresponding definition you will use here. This is just the numerical value of the volume. So if you are considering a particular surface, then you will be certainly knowing the value of the numerical value of the volume there. So you can find out this product always. Now if I just try to define a general expression which we use for the calculation purpose, then this there is a derivation behind that, and that derivation we are not supposed to do in this particular course here, because that's a detailed derivation and this is just a mathematical aspect of that. The definition is in front of you, so you need to calculate this expression basically and put the limit delta V tending to 0. As you do that mathematical analysis for a particular case of Cartesian system, you will achieve the
the definition of, or the expression, the compact expression of divergence of entropy in Cartesian system. And if you repeat the exercise for the cylindrical and for spherical system, you will obtain the individual expressions. But right now here, I am just writing you or giving you a definition of divergence of vector field for general coordinate system, which is defined as h1, h2, h3, del of del u1, h2, h3, and you know all these quantities now. U1 is your first coordinate, h1, h2, h3 are the scale factors, and i1 is your first component of the vector. Then you have another del u2, h1, h3, l2, and del of del u3, h1, h2, i3. So these are, this is the general expression for the divergence of any given vector. If you know the value, anyway, if you know that your vector, in which system your vector is defined, then you can suddenly substitute the values of the components which are given in the vectors, or the functions which are defined as i1, i2, and i3, and then substitute those values back into the expression, you will achieve. Okay, so if I just consider the Cartesian system, then divergence of A, because in Cartesian system your vector would be defined as ax, ax, ay, ay, and az, az. In that case, h1, h2, h3, you know, h1 equals 2, h2 equals 2, h3 equals 2, 1, and u1 is x, u2 is y, and u3 is z. So if I substitute all those values here in this expression, then you will automatically have a result. So this is the value of divergence of any given vector in Cartesian system. Okay, if I generalize it for the other systems, then del dot A would be 1 over h1, h2, h3. Cartesian system, you know, h1 equals to 1, h2 equals to rho, and h3 equals to 1, and your u1 is rho, u2 is y, and u3 is z. So in that case this becomes 1 over rho, then this is del over del rho of h2, h3. So this is rho, a rho plus del over del phi, h1 h3 is 1, and this is a phi plus del over del z of h1 h2 which is rho a z. So this is the definition. And in a spherical system, this a rho, a phi, and a z are the components of vector in three directions. And in a spherical system, h1 is 1, h2 is r, and h3 is r sin theta, u1 is r, u2 is theta, and u3 is phi. Okay, then this del dot A 1 over r square sin theta. Fine. Then this is del over del, del over del del r of this h2, h3, and h2, h3 is r square sin theta ar plus del by del theta of h1, h3 is r sin theta a theta plus del over del phi of h1, h2, and h1, h2 is r a one. This is how we calculate the value of divergence of any given vector in our three coordinate system. If vector is defined in xyz system, you use this expression. If it is defined in rho theta, rho phi z, then you use this expression. And if it is defined in spherical system, you use this system. So next, We'll talk about the physical significance of divergence, what this region represents basically, why we are interested in calculating this particular flux or net flux per unit volume as the volume tends to zero, what is the physical significance of that, and then we will move on to the curl of a vector field, which is another quantity which has another physical importance. We'll talk about the physical significance of divergence first, and then we'll move to the operation curl of a vector field and its calculation in various coordinate system in the next class. Thank you very much.